Please get ready for transcription number 522 and 523. 5 seconds. Start. Mr. Deputy Chairman, Sir, I am grateful to the honorable members who participated in the budget debate and lent general support to my budget proposals. I am all the more grateful to the honorable members who took a critical attitude on the budget, because I do realize we are faced with a complex and very difficult situation. There are no straight answers to many of the questions. There are no simple solutions. Therefore, I do realize that there would be alternative approaches to this situation, and therefore, when honorable members made points which were not in conformity with the budget, it is not as if they had no relevance at all or no validity at all. But I can assure the honorable members that it is not just without any discussion whatsoever or detailed study whatsoever that I have formulated the budget. I have had as much wide discussion as possible, very detailed examination of the various problems, and on that basis I have made judgment and formulated the budget. I do not claim infallibility with regard to my judgment. Therefore, particularly in a situation of this sort, the other points of view are more important than the points of view which are in conformity with the budget. I would assure the honorable members that I shall certainly examine many of the points that have been made, and if there are any deficiencies and distortions, it would be my endeavor to correct them as we go along. Having said that, I would like to say that there was consensus, particularly with regard to the priorities which we have got to observe in tackling this problem. Almost all honorable members emphasized this aspect of inflation, because if the price increase should go on in the same manner as it has been going on during the last 2 years, it would be an end of all our planning process, and it would create very many distortions in the economy as a whole, because it is in the inflationary situation that the income distribution also gets distorted. Therefore, the government attaches great importance to the tackling of the inflationary situation. And naturally, the inflationary situation, first of all, should be tackled on the basis of a financial discipline. That financial discipline has to be observed in three sectors, if I may say so. One is public spending or public consumption, wherein the central government, the state governments, and the various institutions which are attached to these governments are concerned. The second is private consumption, where commercial credit, etc., is being utilized. The third is the illegitimate sector, the black money sector. Unless we tackle all these three sectors, we may not be able to achieve results on an enduring basis. Sir, as far as financial discipline in the government sector is concerned, naturally, the central government will have to set an example. In that regard, even my distinguished predecessor has been reviewing the situation periodically and trying to find out where non-plan or non-developmental expenditure could be curtailed, and where, even when expenditures have been incurred, whether certain projects could be postponed without affecting the immediate economy, particularly projects which have a long gestation period. Therefore, it will have to be a continuing exercise within the central government, where all the ministries will have to cooperate. And I'm glad to say that there has been cooperation and response from all the ministries with regard to this aspect. Naturally, the state governments also have to observe this financial discipline. Sir, honorable members might remember that up to 1972, the state governments had used overdrafts from the Reserve Bank for their resource purposes. And after a certain time, it looked as if there were competition among the states with regard to overdrafts from the Reserve Bank, and this was leading to a very delicate and embarrassing situation. It was towards the end of 1971, when I was in the planning ministry, that we took up this question, and in consultation with the state governments, we came to a decision that these overdrafts should not be permitted and no state government should be allowed to run overdrafts for the purpose of increasing their resources. So various guidelines were laid down for the purpose that if the overdraft continues for more than a week, then notice would be given and even payments would be stopped and so on. Fortunately, it had a good effect, and I'm glad to say that as far as the question of overdraft is concerned, more or less the discipline is being observed by the various state governments. Even though there are certain hard cases in discussion with them and in discussion with the Reserve Bank, we have taken various measures with regard to these one or two states to tide over the situation. Then came from 1971-72 onwards these drought relief and flood relief works. Large sums have been spent on these drought relief and flood relief works. Sir, what I am saying is that economic policies today should be really radically changed. I was shocked, and we were shocked, by the advocacy in favor of monopoly capitalism. No wonder Mr. J.R.D. Tata and Mr. K.K. Birla and others are making statements acclaiming your economic policies. They are, on the one hand, applauding you, helping you in many ways, and on the other hand, they are also helping the counter-revolutionary forces. This is the technique of the monopoly capital prevailing today. They have two strings to their bow. They want to build forces in the opposition and build forces within the government so that in the bargain, it is they who gain and the nation suffers. That is what is happening. I should like in this connection to dispute what the finance minister said by his economic jugglery. No amount of economic jugglery will hide the facts of life. Your annual report of the Reserve Bank of India shows that stagnation in agricultural economy has taken place. Stop.